Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Ivo Siegmann, and welcome to the first seminar of this year in the Northwest Seminar Series of Mathematical Biology and Data Science. This seminar series is co-organized by the Universities of Liverpool, Manchester, and Liverpool John Moores University. Today's seminar is hosted by Liverpool John Moores University and will be presented by Alex Freitas from the University of Kent. I now pass over to my colleague, Elon Correa, who will introduce Alex. Over to you, Elon.
Thank you. Thank you, Ivo. Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Elon Correa, and it is my pleasure to introduce our speaker for today to you. He's Professor Alex Freitas, and I had the pleasure of working with him in the University of Kent at Canterbury as one of his postdocs. A long time ago, I'm not going to say how long, omit that part. So Alex is a professor of computational intelligence and the head of the research at the School of Computing in the University of Kent. He also has an interdisciplinary academic background with a PhD in computer science from the University of Essex in the area of machine learning. And he also has a research-oriented master's degree in biological sciences from the University of Liverpool. And that one was in the area of biology of aging using machine learning and the bioinformatics methods. Alex is also a senior member of the Association for Advancement of Artificial Intelligence. So Alex, I'm looking forward to the talk. Please, I think that we are ready whenever you're ready to start.
Thank you. Let me share my screen again. Okay, so first I would like to thank the organizers for the invitation to give this talk. It's a pleasure. So the title is Machine Learning for Aging Research. It's going to be an interdisciplinary talk involving machine learning and applications to research on the biology of aging. So let me start with an introduction to aging. So we can define aging as a progressive functional decline or a gradual deterioration of a physiological function with time. So basically that means with time, you become increasingly more vulnerable, more likely to die of some disease or another terrible thing. So in the case of humans, that means that the risk of death doubles every 7 or 8 years. That varies a lot across species. Now, most people think of aging as something inevitable, everyone ages at the same speed, but that's far from the truth. So the rate of aging is actually different from the rate of the passage of time. So the passage of time is, of course, a constant for everyone. We all experience the passage of time at exactly the same speed. But we experience aging at very different speeds. So one particular person at the age of 65 might be biologically much older, much younger than another person of the same chronological age. So it's important to distinguish between the two things. And as I said before, there is a huge variability in the rate of aging both across species and across individuals of the same species. Now, this is all good news in one sense, because that means our rate of age is not fixed. To some extent, we can control that by controlling our lifestyle. Some studies with twin brothers or sisters, for instance, suggested that just about 20-25% of aging is genetically determined. So the large majority of your rate of aging is going to depend on your lifestyle choices, what you eat, you know, the lifestyle that you have in general, things that you can control to some extent. So that's good news. And as a result, biologists have been experimenting with interventions for aging for a long time, typically using animal models instead of humans, because it's much harder to do experiments with humans. But in animals, at least, biologists have been very successful actually already in extending a lot of the lifespan of some animals using some combination of genetic, dietary, or pharmacological interventions. Depending on the type of the animal, biologists can extend the lifespan of the animal by a factor of 10, okay, in the case of simple worms, for instance. In the case of mice, which is mammals, a bit closer to humans, they can normally extend the lifespan of a mouse by 30%, in some cases 50%, Okay, so clearly aging can be manipulated. That's no longer science fiction. We can, to some extent, control the rate of aging. Now, experiments with humans are, of course, a lot more complicated, but at least with animals, we can do. Now, a little bit more about the motivation now for aging research. Aging is basically the ultimate cause for a number of age-related diseases. And that's very important because each of those diseases that we mentioned here, cancer, Alzheimer's, diabetes, they are a big biomedical problem by themselves. So if you do research in one of those areas, you're already doing a good service to humanity, because if you discover something there, it's going to be very useful to help to treat lots of people. But each of those diseases is still just affecting a subset of the population. The thing about aging is that it affects everyone. No one can escape. Okay, so from that perspective, it's very important to try to do something about aging, try to slow down aging, to understand aging more, because if you make progress in understanding more about aging, you know, and ideally slowing down aging, we would be making progress simultaneously against a number of age-related diseases, not just one or two, but there is really a large number. Even COVID, for instance, I didn't put COVID in this slide because technically it's not an age-related disease, it affects everyone. But the reality is that the majority of people who die of COVID, for instance, die because they are old. So the same goes to all those diseases there. The majority of people who die of cancer, Alzheimer, diabetes, the fact is they wouldn't die if they were 20 or 30 years younger, because in that case, they wouldn't have that disease in the first place. So from that perspective, aging is by far the greatest cause of death. Okay, if you consider ultimate cause, not the immediate cause of death, like the specific disease. Now, as I said, the aging affects everyone. And what we would like to do, of course, is to slow down aging. And when I mean what I mean by that is not just increasing the lifetime of an individual, because that by itself wouldn't be so good. If you extend the last few years of life where people are very frail, very old, that's not so good. What we are trying to do is to increase the so-called healthy lifespan, the period of time in which the person remains healthy before they started to suffer from horrible age-related disease. And the good news is that the majority of the interventions which expanded the lifespan in general, they also have the side effect of improving the health lifespan. So those mice that I mentioned before, where the lifespan is extended by 30% and 50%, they not only live longer, they live in better health, actually, for the majority of their life. And this is becoming increasingly more important because the proportion of the older population aged 60 years or over is increasing relatively fast. So a couple of numbers here to put that into context. In 2015, only about 12.3% of the world population was aged 60 years or over. Now it's estimated that by 2050, just 35 years later, that proportion will almost double to 21.3%. So you can imagine the kind of pressure that we're going to have in public health systems like the National Health Service, things like that. Okay, so clearly we have to do something about aging. It's becoming more and more a crucial problem. So the kind of research that I try to do is try to do research to discover more about age-related genes or some characteristics of age in general, which hopefully can help us to understand more about that and lead, hopefully, in the future to the design of better treatment to age-related disease, or perhaps even to slow down aging. So that's the motivation for aging in general. But a more specific question for those of us who are computer scientists are, okay, so but age is a biological problem, so why should a computer scientist like me bother about that? What can I do about it? Well, it turns out that you can do a lot about it, because experiments with aging in humans is extremely hard, partly because of the long lifespan of humans. So imagine, if I wanted to follow the lifetime of a person to observe in detail what's happening with their age, how many years I would have to follow that person, that group of people. It's already hard enough to get funding to do a five-year research project, imagine, for a project involving decades of observation. So as a result, most research on aging is done by using much simpler model organisms. In some cases, mice, which at least is a mammal, but still quite far from human. But at the same time, there is a growing amount of data in age-related databases, which are already available on the web, because for many decades, biologists have been accumulating that data. Some of it is data about humans, although the majority is about the animals. And in the case of humans, we have, for instance, longitudinal studies of human age, where people have collected hundreds or thousands of variables about the characteristics of a group of people, sometimes thousands of people, who have been followed for many years, sometimes decades. So some of that data is already available. So it's natural to try to apply machine learning algorithms to that type of data to try to extract aging-related patterns from aging-related database. But ideally, we should, of course, try to have strong collaboration with biologists and the biogerontologists in general, because it's a very, you know, complex area by itself. It's more complex than any single disease. If you think about the cancer, it's already very complicated. There are many types of cancer, you know, but age is even more complicated because, you know, it's just one of the multiple aspects associated with age. You tend to get more cancer as you get older, but there are many other things which happen bad for you when you get older. So it's even more complex, I guess, than any single disease that you might think. So it's important to collaborate with biologists. And finally, from a more practical perspective, machine learning experiments are relatively fast and cheap, at least much faster and cheaper than the kinds of biological experiments that you need to do with genes, that kind of thing. The trade-off for that is that even if you have a very clever, very sophisticated machine learning algorithm, if you just apply some machine learning algorithm to some aging-related data set, biological data set, clearly, you are not going to convince any biologist just with the result of that experiment. It's never going to be conclusive because it's always, at the end of the day, just some computational experiment. If you want to really show that one gene or protein is involved in aging, at some point, you're going to have to do some wet lab experiments. But at least we can use those fast and cheap machine learning experiments to give us some clue to identify some potential patterns that might be useful for biogerontologists, and we can then discuss with biologists. If the biologists agree that that's an interesting and promising pattern, then they can now justify the use of a more time-consuming, more expensive biological experiment to further validate the preliminary hypothesis suggested by a computer. So that's the broad motivation for interdisciplinary research on machine learning applied to aging. So now I'm going to switch mainly to the types of machine learning tasks that we are going to be talking about. And everything that I'll talk about here is about one type of machine learning task called the classification. So if you're not familiar with that, the basic idea is simple. When we get a data set, we divide the data set initially into two parts. We have the training set and the test set. And the one characteristic of both sets is that we have two types of variables. We have this class variable, which is a special variable that I would like to predict. And I have the other variables, which are called the predictive features or attributes. So the goal of the classification algorithm is to learn from the training set a model associating the values of the features to the class so that I'm then able to predict the value of the class variable based on the values of those features. And once I learn this model from the training set, I apply the model in the test set where the algorithm is not aware of the values of the classes. So from the algorithm perspective, we are doing a prediction here, okay? And then you can measure the quality of that prediction, how many cases the prediction was correct. So the important point is that in the training set, the algorithm has access to the values of the class, so that's why it can learn, but we don't give that information to the algorithm in the test set because we wanted to simulate a prediction. So the classification workflow, very simple, in a very simplified way, is something like that. We start with a data set, then we apply a classification algorithm, then we learn some type of classification model, predictive model from this data. Now, broadly speaking, this model can be divided into two types of models. We have in terms of how interpretable they are. So we have some models which are black box models. That means we don't really understand what the model is doing, how the model performs its classification. And we have other models which are so-called white box models. We can understand what the model is doing because the model is expressed using some type of representation that the user can understand. Sometimes the user needs a bit of training to understand the representation, but at least in principle, it is doable. unlike the black box. Now, these days, the majority of people working on classification tend to use mainly black box algorithms, mainly because in general, not always, but in general, they tend to achieve some higher predictive performance than the white box ones. But that's not always the case, depends on the data set. But even in the case of black box models, it's still possible in some cases to interpret the model in some way, although the initial model is not directly interpretable. We can apply some kind of transformation post-processing to the model in order to interpret it. And that's one of the approaches that we're going to use here. When we use a black box, at least we put some effort into interpreting that model. And one example, for instance, we can have some kind of a hybrid white box and black box approach. You can compute feature importance measures from an ensemble of decision trees, which is one of the techniques that I'm going to talk about later in the talk. Okay, so the rest of the talk now is going to be an overview of the three case studies involving the application of the machine learning to data about the biology of aging. So the first case study involves predicting if a gene is associated with each of 27 age-related diseases. So in the spirit of understanding aging from a more systemic and holistic perspective, as I said before, not just one age-related disease, we try to have some data having many age-related diseases there in the data set, and they try to see commonalities, you know, similarities in the difference between genes which can predict those diseases as a whole. So in that case, the machine learning approach we are using is a modular neural network for coping with different types of predictive features. So for each case study, I'm going to give you just the basic idea, but of course, if you want to know more details, you can always chat about that in more detail later. But the basic idea is something like that. So we have those different types of features. One is gene expression, another is protein-protein interaction, which is binary features, whether or not one gene interacts with another. Then gene ontology, which describes the functions of genes according to a predefined terminology. And then we have biological pathways from this particular database here, PathDIP. So for each of those types of features, we initially train one encoder neural network. So we do that in a modular way. That's why you call that a modular neural network approach. So we train one module, one encoder module for each of those types of features. Then we get the output of those types of features, of those networks, and we combine them using another module called the combiner. So basically what we do is after training the encoders, we drop the last layer, the output layer from the encoder, and they make a direct connection between the output of the last hidden layer in the encoder that's used now as the input for the combiner. So the combiner is going to combine the result of training the four separate modular neural networks. And then finally, we make the predictions about the 27 age-related diseases. So without going too much detail, just the main characteristics of the neural net. So each encoder module can be used as an independent neural net classifier, as I said. So it has three hidden layers. As usual, the number of neurons decreases as you move on to the layers because you try to create more and more abstractive features. So in the last output layer, we have the 27 neurons, each one corresponding to one age-related disease. And then, as I said before, so after you train each of those modules, you simply remove the output layer. You can now use the output of the neurons in the third layer, third hidden layer, as high-level features used as input by the combiner. And the combiner does the entire combination in the final prediction. And the combiner has two extra hidden layers as well, okay? So what are the advantages, the motivation to use this kind of modular neural net approach? Why not just one neural net applied to all the data together? Well, we have a few points here. So first, we can add the new feature types without retraining each module. So in the example that I showed you, we had four feature types, but maybe in the future you'd like to add a fifth feature type. So in a standard scenario, you'd need to retrain the entire neural network if you show all the data to the network at once. But since you have this modular approach, you just need to train out this new module and you need to retrain the combiner as well. But all the modules that you trained previously, they don't need to be trained anymore. They're still valid as long as the data is still there. You didn't change the data very much, okay? So that modularity makes it easier to incorporate the new feature types in the future. That's a practical motivation. Another issue, which is also more conceptual, to some extent practical as well, is that by analyzing the results of each module separately, we can have a clear idea about the effect of each module, that is, the effect of each feature type in the predictive performance of the whole module. So maybe I want to understand not only how the predictions are done in general, but I wanted to know which of the feature types is more important is doing better predictions than others. So the modular architecture helps me with that as well. And then finally, from a computational efficiency perspective, we have reduced the memory consumption because of the modules now, I don't need to load all the modules into the memory of the computer at the same time. I can train just one module at a time. So that saves a lot of memory. Big neural networks tended to take a lot of memory. They take a lot of time to train. So those are practical motivations for the modular approach. So the next step is the creation of the data set. So in this case, we got just about all the genes which are coding proteins in the human genome, about 20,000. Then we got from another database the collection of the genes associated with age-related diseases. Then we create a data set where each gene, each instance from the perspective of the machine learning algorithm, each data point is going to be described by all those features that I mentioned before, the protein-protein interaction, gene expression, et cetera, plus a special class variable to be predicted, which now, since we are talking about the 27 age-related diseases, I have effectively 27 class labels. So each class label is a binary one, indicating whether or not the gene has each of those 27 diseases, defined as if the gene has an SNP associated with that disease, okay? Then the predictive feature types I already mentioned before, those four, okay? So given this data set, the next step is to define the what types of baseline algorithms we are going to compare against the results of the neural networks. So we use a number of different baselines. So the most natural one, arguably, we can simply try and retry a standard neural network applied to the entire combination of all the feature types together, no modularity, just as a natural baseline. But we also tried other powerful types of classifiers. One is a gradient boosted tree, which also involves concatenating all feature types. Then we tried a more standard, simple classifier, but which has the advantage of interpretability because biomedical science can, broadly speaking, interpret the results of logistic regression. So it's much simpler. So again, we concatenate all the feature types, but since we have so many different types of features, we apply some kind of regularization there to reduce the number of variables. We also tried a classifier, which is not really a computational machine learning technique, it's just a kind of common sense technique to evaluate the impact of bias in the creation of those data sets. Because one of the issues when you create biological data sets like this, there is always a bias because some genes, some proteins tend to be a lot more studied than other types of genes, okay? So we don't have the ideal data set where all the genes, proteins are equally distributed in the database. That does not exist, there is a bias. So as a very simple baseline classifier, we have this naive classifier, which simply ranks the genes based on their study popularity, okay? Now, for each of those types of classifiers, we also tried to train the classifier with just one of those four types of features, one at a time. We also tried the idea of combining the features not immediately together, but selecting the feature type sequentially. So initially, we start with no feature type at all. Then we try systematically all the feature types, select the best one, fix that, then try now to select the second best feature type and so on. So we create a series of feature types using this kind of forward sequential selection procedure of the neural net modules. And we also try the stacking versions of the gradient boosted tree logistic regression, where basically stacking is a general machine learning methodology. You first do some prediction using classifier, then you get the predictions of the classifier. Instead of using those predictions immediately, you treat those predictions as input to another classifier. So you have another classifier learning from the predictions of the previous classifiers, okay? So we tried that for gradient boosted tree and the logistic regression as well. So in total, several different approaches. And those are the results using tenfold cross-validation as usual. We plot here the results in terms of the average area under the ROC curve. which is a measure of predictive performance. If you're not familiar with it, the main point is that it's a number varying between 0 and 1, but 0.5 means basically random prediction. So 0.5 is already a very bad value. So in practice, to have good ROC values at the end of the curve, you need values like 0.7, 0.8, something like that, okay? So we measure that separately for each of the 27 classes, age-related disease. So as you can see, overall, the best result was achieved by the neural net with the modular approach, with an error under the ROC curve of 0.88, which is just slightly better than the second best classifier, which was gradient boosted trees, concatenating all the features. So clearly there is no statistically significant difference of performance here. But in most of the baselines, there is a very clear difference of performance between the modular approach of the neural net and the other baselines. We also applied, of course, some statistical tests of significance. So we actually tried the two approaches. The conventional approach for statistical significance is just to try the no hypothesis significance testing, but that has been increasingly criticized in the last few years, a number of limitations. So we also tried a more recent approach, relatively speaking, which is based on a Bayesian test of statistical significance. And the standard approach based on no hypothesis significance test and the Bayesian approach, they were based on the Wilcoxon signed rank test. So both in this particular set of experiments, both types of testing gave conceptually similar results, no big difference between their results. The overall conclusion in terms of statistical significance is that the modular neural net significantly outperformed the baseline approach with a couple of exceptions. As I mentioned before, clearly no difference, no substantial difference between the modular neural net versus the gradient boosted trees concatenating other features, and also no significant difference with respect to the logistical regression concatenating all features and with stacking as well. So that was the analysis of the results in terms of predictive performance, but we are also interested in trying to find out some biometrical pattern, you know, some result which you can discuss, show to a biologist with expertise on aging, and they try to discover something new about the biology of aging. So to do that, we have this problem that we use the black box classifier. So as I said before, in that case, you have to put a lot of effort into interpreting the output of the black box classifier. And we did that in two ways. One, we tried to use some kind of a clustering of the instance based on the output of the classifier there. I'm not going into details. And the other approach is basically using directly the value of the probability predicted by the neural network for the examples that the neural network predicts as negative class, not having the disease. So in some case, depending on the value of that probability, you can infer that the prediction, the data, for instance, might not be correct, because just because the data is annotated as having the information that there is no disease, that does not mean the prediction is correct, okay? So anyway, so for the first approach based on clustering, we have these results here. We found a couple of interesting negative instances for class type 2 diabetes, for instance. So a couple of genes here, which seem to be doing something interesting, and they are predicted for the network as based on that analysis of the clustering with the other genes that are taking into account the output of the network. They seem to be doing something interesting. And the other, as I said, is the probability of the so-called false positive. So basically, if the gene is annotated in the data set as not having the disease, but the algorithm predicts the gene as having the disease, as associated with the disease, as long as that probability is very high, technically, it's still a false positive according to the data, because there is a positive prediction, and in the data is not registered as a positive, it's registered as a negative. But if the probability is high, you can argue it's quite possible that the algorithm is wrong and the data is wrong, actually, because the data is far from complete. Okay, so just because in the data there is no annotation saying that the gene is associated with disease, that's not necessarily the truth. Maybe no one did the experiment yet to prove that the gene is associated with the disease. So according to that criterion, we have identified those genes here as potentially associated with disease. The probabilities, to be fair, are not very high anyway, but they're still much larger than the baseline probability, because each of those diseases is relatively rare in the data. So it's much the prior probability of the disease is much smaller than those values here. So it still is a reasonable value for the false positive probability. Okay, so that was the first case study. Moving on now to the second case study. In this case, the task is to predict if a gene is over or underexpressed with age in the brain. And the type of machine learning technique we are using now is random forest, which is another classical powerful type of classification model. But in this case, we are not going to propose any modification in the algorithm itself. We are using the standard random forest algorithm. What we are proposing in this paper is just a different way of interpreting the output of the random forest algorithm. So it's about the interpretability of the model rather than modifying the model. So starting with the data preparation, which involves combining data from mice in the rat to human data. So initially, we got data on age-related brain gene expression from database on the web, specifically about the mice and the rats. Then we identified the genes which are over and underexpressed in the brain, again, based on database on the web. And finally, we use this mapping, finding the homolog genes in humans, okay, using standard bioinformatics techniques to do that. Once we do that, then we have a data set with about 17,000 instance genes and about 7,500 predictive features. An important point is that there is a massive imbalance in the class distribution. If you check the numbers here, 96.8% of the genes, they are annotated with the class no change of expression with age in the brain. Only a very small proportion undergo semi-change, 2.4% are overexpressed, and the less than 1%, not 0.8%, are underexpressed with age in the brain. So that creates a big problem for a classification algorithm, because most classification algorithms would tend to be completely dominated by the majority class. It would tend to predict almost always the majority class. So we have to do something about that. So what we have done about that is to implement a simple strategy called undersampling. So we simply undersample the examples of the large classes. Basically, we throw away lots of data from those large classes in order to reduce the number of examples in the large classes to be the same as the number of examples in the smallest class. So that leads to the creation of a data set like that we have. In this case, we are using as predictor features just one type of predictive feature, which is the gene ontology, which basically is an ontology, a predefined collection of terms specifying the functions of genes, which are often used to annotate genes to describe the functions of genes. So all the features in this case are binary. Okay, so the data looks like this in this kind of tabular format, like an Excel file. So each row of the table corresponds to one gene. Each of the columns corresponds to a binary feature indicating the presence or absence of a goal term annotation for that particular gene. And then the class variable is one of the three classes, as I said before, overexpressed, underexpressed, or no change. So given this data, you apply a standard random forest algorithm to the data, and then you try to interpret the model. Now the question is that how you are going to interpret the model? Because although a single decision tree algorithm is easily interpretable as long as the tree is not very big, it's much harder to interpret a random forest, which, as the name suggests, it's a forest, a large collection of decision trees. So there are too many decision trees, so we cannot interpret all those decision trees. So that's technically a black box model. However, we can use some measure of feature importance to identify the most important features. So in that sense, we transform the black box into a kind of a gray box, so to speak, based on the influence of the variables in the model. So if a variable is very important in the predictive model learned by the algorithm, it's going to have a high value of a feature importance measure. If a variable is not important at all, it's going to have a very low value. The problem with those, and there are several of those feature importance measures available in the literature, okay? You can choose many available. The problem is that all of them, as far as we know, they are all the previous measures. They are all, I can say, they are all coarse-grained in the sense that they are evaluating the importance of the variable as a whole. So in our case, the variable, the binary variable indicating whether or not a gene is annotated for gene ontology term, technically, that variable has two values. let's say, the positive value, yes, indicating the gene is annotated with a gene ontology term, or the negative value, basically saying the gene is not annotated with negative value. But it's important to realize now there is a big asymmetry in the interpretation of those two values. Because if the value is a positive value, the feature is positive, I'm clearly making a very, very informative statement. I'm saying this gene is annotated with this function, for instance, DNA repair. So I'm saying this gene is involved in DNA repair. But if I just tell you, this gene is not annotated with that function, for example, this gene is not annotated with DNA repair. Okay, you learned a little bit from that. You know now that the gene is not doing one out of 1,000 possible functions. But you really didn't learn very much about what the gene is actually doing. So you just know that the gene is not doing one out of many possible things. So it's much more vague information. So it's much more valuable to a biologist by comparison with the information that the gene is doing something. Therefore, it makes sense to make the positive value to be more important when computing the value of the feature hypothesis measure. And another issue is that the positive values are very sparse. Okay, so if you don't do anything about that, again, the algorithm is going to be dominated by the predictive power of the non-informative negative values, because there are many more negative feature values than positive feature values. And finally, analogous to the problem of the lack of annotation that I mentioned before in the previous case study, just because one gene is not annotated with one particular GO term, that does not mean really that the gene does not have that GO term. It only means, so far, no one has done an experiment to prove that the gene has that kind of annotation. In other words, the type of information that you have is basically is absence of information, okay, about the function of the gene, which is very different, absence of evidence, let's say, for the function of the gene, which is very different from saying evidence or absence, okay? So based on those considerations, what we needed then is a fine-grained measure of a feature value importance, as I said, which emphasizes more the importance of the positive value, ignoring the negative value. So that's the basic idea of this approach that we're proposing to interpret the random forest model. So the basic idea of the algorithm for emphasizing the positive values can be summarized into these few lines of code here at a very high level abstraction. The detailed algorithm is in the paper. But the basic idea, so for each predictive feature, you scan all the forest, all the trees in the forest, and for each tree, you find all the nodes in the decision tree where the feature occurs. You get all the paths in the forest from the root to the leaf node of the tree. And then among all the paths containing the feature that you are evaluating now in the current iteration of the external loop here, and then for all those paths, you only keep the paths where the feature appears with a positive value. In the paths where the feature appears with a negative value, you don't care, you throw those paths away. Okay? So you aggregate now all those paths with the positive value of the feature, and then you compute a measure of precision, the probability that the prediction of the rule is correct, based on those positive values. So that's the essence of the algorithm. So if you apply that idea, then you get now a ranking of the features based on that variable importance measure. And then the question is, more precisely, which measure you are using. In this case, we use the standard measure as part of the overall processing of the technique before you apply our post-processing technique. So we're using a standard measure of the average class impurity decrease. So that measures the effect of a feature in the model, how much it is decreasing the class impurity when the feature is selected over all the nodes in the tree. So that's the standard measure baseline for us, okay? So that's one traditional measure. Sorry, the baseline for us, sorry, is not that one. We're using a more appropriate baseline measure, which is this one, which we got from a recent paper, which is called the intervention in prediction measure. So the idea here is that this variable importance measure is computing the percentage of instances where the classification of the instance used that feature out of all the instances, or perhaps for a subset of the instance of interest. So that's a kind of flexible definition. But the important point is that it's measuring directly the influence of the feature in a flexible way, because you can define the group of instances in which you are going to measure the influence. Could be all the instances or a subset of instances. And since we have those three class labels having very different relative frequencies, as I showed you before, it makes sense to ask what is the value of the importance measure according to this measure, for each of those classes separately, because they're so different, you know, it's very different predicting each of those classes. So we compute the feature importance for each class label separately. And that flexibility is the main reason why we chose this measure instead of that more standard baseline measure, which is one of the common ones in the literature, okay? So we compared now with this baseline feature importance measure, the intervention in prediction measure. So let's first see the results of the baseline. Now, so that's the ranking of the five top features according to the baseline intervention in prediction measure. And as you can see, a striking result is that despite the fact that we are computing the measure separately for each class label, which we thought it would be very flexible, we would manage to distinguish the patterns across the classes, that was a big disappointment, because despite that difference, we still get results which are very similar, almost the same set of five top-ranked features for all the classes. And we attributed that kind of result to the fact that although the measure was designed to be very flexible, you can vary per class, but still it's not being able to distinguish between the positive and negative GoTerm annotations. So the computation of the measure, the importance measure, is still dominated by the negative values, because as I said before, we have many more negative values than positive values in the data set. So that was a kind of disappointing result, okay? So the next measure is the one that we are proposing, which is based on this idea of emphasizing the positive feature values. Now we can get clearly separate results, because as you can see, the top five ranked features for the overexpressed class are quite different from the features for the no change in expression class. The trade-off is that we don't get any top-ranked feature at all to be reported in the case of the under-express class, simply because our measure is more strict in terms of the predictive performance. We have this, one of the criteria that we take into account to compute the measure is the precision of the rule, the precision of the predictions, which is not the case of the intervention in prediction measure, which is very flexible about that. So we use a stricter precision-based criterion, and as a result, we are not able to find any reliable feature for predicting the under-expressed class, which is not very surprising considering that less than 1% of the data belongs to the under-expressed class anyway. So even the overexpressed class is already very difficult to predict, but at least we managed to predict that. So at least we managed, by using this variation of this proposed measure of feature importance, we managed to achieve some clear separation between the classes, okay, and the hopefully detect features which are more relevant for a biologist. So that was the second case study. And finally, in the third case study, this is switching the gear now. That's not about molecular biology, not about genes, proteins. That's actually data from people, human data. So we are now predicting if an individual will develop age-related diseases in longitudinal data sets. So the machine learning approach that we use here is a proposed variation of the random forest algorithms again, but now the variation is tailored for longitudinal data classification. So what I mean by longitudinal data is something like that. The idea that each variable has not only one measure, but it is repeatedly measured over time. So you follow one particular individual or patient for many years, and every year or every 2 years, you repeat the measurements of some blood tests or other tests, and you collect all this data, and you store the data with a time index there so that you know you can observe now the evolution of the values of the variable with time. Okay, which intuitively is something very relevant for studying aging. So in this case, we use mainly data from the English Longitudinal Study of Aging, which has about 12,000 participants, which is freely available data. Anyone can use, you just need to register. But there are other databases just for you to know. Then we create the semi-classification data set from that kind of ELSA database, which basically consists of people who are 50 years old or older, that interviewed every 2 years in a so-called wave. And we focus in particular, there are thousands of variables describing those individuals. We don't use all those variables. We focus on a collection of about 100, 140 different features, which are all biomedical data collected by a nurse. And the nurse collects that data only every 2 waves. So we have data collected only every 4 waves. And after all the many steps of the data preparation, data cleaning, took a lot of time to prepare the data in a format suitable for machine learning. We have about 7,000 individuals, 140 biomedical features, and the 10 different data sets, all the data sets sharing the same predictive features, but each of them having a different class variable, okay, which involves the diagnosis of diseases in the last wave, wave 8. So we try to use the data from the past, from past waves, in order to predict whether the patient will get a disease in the next wave, in this case, the wave 8. Those are the diseases here. Okay, so the standard approach to cope with this kind of longitudinal data, if you don't use any kind of longitudinal algorithm, would be something like that. Since standard classification algorithms cannot cope with longitudinal data, we would have to simply collapse all that data, flatten the data, put everything into a big, very wide table where the distinction between the time index of the features would be lost. So in this example here, the first group of variables would be from feature 1 to feature n. Then the next variable, which we call here variable feature n plus 1, from the perspective of a standard classification algorithm, that would be a variable which has nothing to do with the other variables. But we understand the structure of the data in terms of time index, so we know that is variable here is kind of the same variable as the feature 1, only differing in the time index. So if the feature 1 is cholesterol, for instance, feature 1 would be cholesterol in maybe wave 2, feature n plus 1 would be in cholesterol in wave 4, for instance, the next wave. So we know that, but if you use a classification algorithm, the algorithm wouldn't know that because you lose the temporal information when you flatten the data. But that's the price that you pay for using a standard classification algorithm. But we don't use a standard classification algorithm. So we developed our own longitudinal version of a classification algorithm. So our longitudinal algorithm copes with the longitudinal data like this. So we create the data, again, as in this kind of tabular format, but we keep the time index now. So each feature now is indexed, not only by a sequential number, but also by a sequential number of the wave, the time index of the feature. And the algorithm now can take that time index into account. And the idea to take that time index into account is very simple, is a simple variation of a standard random forest algorithm. So a standard random forest algorithm would have to choose in each node of the decision tree, you would have to choose the variable which is the best data splitting feature at each tree node, choosing based on the predictive performance of the feature. But now that we have the time index as an available criterion, we consider two criteria. One is the predictive power of the feature, and the second one is the time. So first we compare two features, we see if they have about the same predictive power. If the predictive power is about the same, instead of choosing based on the predictive power, we choose the most recent feature. So we introduce a kind of background knowledge, if you like, a preference for the most recent features, based on the argument that in principle it makes more sense for a medical doctor, for instance, to make a diagnosis whether or not you're going to have a heart attack 2 years later based on the value of cholesterol that you have now rather than on the value of the cholesterol that you had like 6 or 8 years ago. So broadly speaking, the time index helps us to choose the most recent features. Okay, so very briefly, I'm running out of time, but these are the results here. We compared the predictive performance, again, the area under the Rocky curve of the lexicographic approach against the standard random forest and not lexicographic. In most cases, not always, but in most cases, the lexicographic approach version of random forest achieves a better result than the non-lexicographic one. Although the overall, the results are significant just for one of the measures of specificity, not for the geometric mean of specificity and sensitivity, although in this case, the difference is also quite substantial. And in terms of interpretation, in that case, what you can do again, in the spirit of trying to understand the agent as a whole, not just one disease at a time, so we can identify the most important features in each of those data sets for predicting each disease, then we can contrast the data across all the diseases that we are trying to predict. So we can see for each of the top ranked features, how many of the diseases that the feature is highly ranked for the prediction of that feature. So features like a clothing disorder, for instance, turns out to be useful for the prediction of many diseases, not just one. Same thing about the gender of the patient, for instance, and so on. So you can have an idea about the aging process as a whole. Okay, so that was the conclusion of the case studies. So just to conclude, I would like to acknowledge now a number of people. So the first two case studies that I have presented here, the main author in that work is my former postdoc, Fabio Fabris. He did that when he was at Kent, and now he moved it to a job in industry. Then the experiments with the longitudinal random forest algorithm, that's the work of my PhD students, Caio Ribeiro at Kent. Then the first two case studies involved a lot of collaboration with people, biologists in general, from the University of Liverpool. And also in the experiments with the neural net, it was very computationally intensive, so we need to use a lot of computer power. We actually managed to have access to some powerful computers in Google there, thanks to my former PhD student, Khalid Salama, who is now working at Google. Okay, so I'll stop here now. I'm available to answer any questions. Thank you for the attention.
Thanks a lot, Alex, for this really nice talk. Are there any questions? So you can unmute yourself or you can ask them in the chat as well, if you like. I will keep an eye on that.
So if I can ask a question. So yeah, so Alex, thanks for the talk, very interesting. So about the third study, where you are predicting if an individual will develop age-related diseases. So how did you measure the dependent variable? Is it a binary variable, for instance, developed or did not develop? And if the person developed more than one disease, how do you deal with that as well? Yes. And also, yeah, if you could then explain as well, there may be very, very many confounders on these measurements, isn't it? For instance, age, gender, if the person had a previous health issue, comorbidities. So how did you deal with all of these variables then?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, okay, good questions. So about the first one, yes, each of the class variables or dependent variables, as you call them, each of them is a binary variable. To define that, we had to go through the original variables in the ELSA data, because the ELSA data database does not have a variable clearly labeled like that. Yes or no, the patient has this disease in this way. That variable does not exist. But it has several variables describing things like that. Has the patient been recently diagnosed with a disease, with this particular disease, yes or no? Or is the patient carrying some information about this disease from the past? We have to combine basically the values of three, for each disease, like heart attack, for instance, we had to combine the value of three variables about that disease, referring to past data in the database. So we combine that information using a simple if-then rule there, and depending on the combination of the values of those variables, not a trivial, then we have a definition of the variable. So at the end, we get a variable which is, just says yes or no, whether or not the patient is diagnosed with that particular disease in that particular wave. And we have one variable like that for wave two, another for wave four, and so on. Okay, so that's the data creation. But you asked another question about the variable. Sorry, can you repeat the second part of the first question? I think one was that. And
yes, then the confounders. For instance, yeah, how do you know then that the person developed the disease because of aging or because of other health issues, previous comorbidities?
So confounder is of course an issue every time that we are doing to doing this kind of prediction. Now we don't explicitly cope with the confounders. What we do indirectly, we cope with them because we have variables like age, gender, all those are predictive variables. So in the presentation here, I simplified, of course, very quickly. I just talked about the longitudinal variables. But in addition to the longitudinal variables, we also have a few variables which are non-longitudinal. So there are things like gender, okay, age. Well, age technically changes with time as well, but you don't need to have a value of age in every wave because it's deterministic. So once you know the value of age in one wave, you are done. So you just use one value of age in one wave. So we put those variables there, the potential confounders like age, gender, they are there in the data set. So if those variables are important, the nature of the random forest algorithm, since it's built on decision tree, it has the option of choosing those variables at the top of the decision tree. So suppose, for instance, that the gender is a very strong confounder, okay, is going to have a huge importance in the prediction. So if the random forest algorithm detects that, the random forest algorithm could put age at the root node of the decision tree and create two subtrees, one subtree for male and female. Then from that point on, the random forest algorithm builds a subtree for male, another subtree for female. So it segments the data automatically. based on all those potential variables. So that's all done in a data-driven way. We don't explicitly have to cope with that as in classical statistics. The algorithm is very flexible and it tries all possible combinations and to sort out which one gives the best predicted performance.
Okay, thank you. Yeah. So just a last question, if I may. On the first study, you mentioned about the modular neural network, isn't it? Yeah. That's, and then you compare that to some boosted trees algorithms.
Yes.
And so the neural net was slightly better than the boosted trees in terms of performance. You said may not be statistically significant, but it was slightly better. But in terms of computational time, then can you tell us in terms of computational time, how they compare?
Yes, I don't have the exact figures now, but for sure the gradient boosted tree should be a lot faster than the neural network. So if you are interested in saving time, definitely the gradient boosted tree should be faster. But at least our approach, as I explained, it helps to cope a bit with the problem with very slow neural network training because we use the modular approach. So that helps to some extent. But even if the modular approach, I don't have the figures, but I would say that probably the neural network is much slower still than the gradient boosted tree, definitely.
Okay, thank you. Thanks, Alex.
No problem.
So I got a question from the chat. Someone asks about the first case study. If there is any specific reason to concatenate all features and not using the modular approach for baseline models. So I'm not sure if you actually did this all the time, but in the end, it seemed that combining all the features actually increased performance, didn't it?
Yeah, well, part of the motivation for the modularity approach of the neural network was because the neural network is so slow to train or so time-consuming to train, takes so much memory, etc. But it increased performance as well. So yeah, we didn't try directly the same type of modular approach as we tried for the neural network, but we tried something which combines the features in different ways in the case of the baselines. So if I can go back quickly to the slides, let me see if I can find all the slides. We could try, it's a good point, we could try a closer implementation of the modular approach for the other baselines. But what we tried, let me remind you here. So we tried things like the forward sequential selection of the, let me see. No, that's for the forward sequential. No, we tried just a stack inversion, We tried the stack inversion of gradient boosted tree logic screen, but we didn't try anything like a modular, no. So in the results, the modular approach we tried just, So we could try both the modular approach and then the forward sequential approach. We could try for the baseline as well. We didn't try. It's a good point. You could try that in the future. We only tried the stacking, which is a more sophisticated approach as well, but stacking is still not a modular. So we could try that in the future. That's true. We didn't try.
I didn't get any more questions from the chat. So if there are no more questions, then I would like to thank you for being here. I just would like to announce the next seminars. In the next week, we won't have a seminar, but the week after that, we will have a talk by Professor Lisa Manning. And this will be at 2 p.m. on Monday, the 22nd of February, and is hosted by the University of Manchester. The week after that, we will have a talk by Dr. Florian Pein, again on Wednesday at 1 p.m. And then even further in the future, Professor Rebecca Shipley from University College London. So thanks a lot to all of you and hope to see many of you again in the upcoming seminars.